Classic Thursday. This is day four, and we're about to get it on with Shane Van Boning versus Johnny Archer for the hot seat. We're coming to you live from the Turning Stone Casino and Resort in Verona, New York. I'm upstate Olive AZB TV, and we're going to have some guest commentators sit in for this match. It looks like it's going to be Donnie Mills and Michael Yetnik in the booth for this great match. We would like everybody to spread the word and let everybody else know that we are live here. Before we get started and underway, because Mike Zuglin is rushing us, we're going to go through some commercials.
Slick shaft maintenance system.
Billiard Engineering provides 9 micron rated films of 3 different grits. They're specifically selected to progressively put that glassy smooth feel on the shaft and keep it there. We also provide a patented burnishing block to ensure the pressure of each film is evenly distributed around the entire shaft. The results are incredible.
Quick Slick shaft maintenance system.
At the following locations: Pool Dog, Amazon, BilliardEngineering.com.
Grimaldi Pool Tables, folks, right here. You heard this name mentioned many a times. I got to go through these real quick. Mike Zuglin is working his way down from the front of the arena. Make sure to get in touch with Thomas Grimaldi and family. Billiard Product Reviews, like their Facebook page. John Barton, JB Cases, get yours from John. Baltimore City Cues, they have everything from tips to tables. CastilleLeatherGoods.com. Anything and everything in leather. You come up with a design, they will make it for you. ChalkySticks.com. Downloadable for iOS and Android devices. It's free. ChalkySticks.com. Josh Q's LTD, Mike Zuglin's main sponsor. Greg Antonakis, get your Southwest from the best. But Greg now reassures me that he has a bundle of Predator Qs for sale, so reach out to them on Facebook or send them an email. KamuiTips.com. Get your Roku chalk right there. The Kings of Vapor for all your vaping needs, and also the Kings of Billiards in Akron, Ohio. Quick Slick, BilliardEngineering.com. Available in all locations. Light-systems.com for your LED lighting. Mike Burton of Josh Q's, mbqs.com. Dream Challenge 2018, USA versus Russia. It's a pay-per-view. Go over to abnbilliards.ru and purchase yours right there, September 16th through the 18th. There it is, 2018 U.S. International Nine Ball Open. AccuStats is running the whole show. In fact, this is Pat Fleming's baby. If you want to be a vendor, spectator or a participant, I suggest you get over to AccuStats right away. Hustlin' Clothing, that's Tony Harrigan, HustlinUSA.com. Get all your gear right there from Hustlin'. There's the Roku. That's the new chalk right there. No mess. Kamui heard the verbal messy parts of it and said, we're going to rectify it. We do hear you. And they did. Simonis cloth, the best you can use in the world, along with the best balls, are Aramith. Just going to listen into Mike Zuglin as soon as he gets ready to make the announcement, and then we'll be underway. Donnie Mills and Michael Yetnik in the booth as soon as we get underway.
A little bit behind. That's because Jason's out. Otherwise, we'd be way ahead. All right. Table number 7. These two gentlemen are have one loss, so we're going to eliminate one into fourth place, and the other one will continue on with a chance still to win the tournament. Minimum third, and that person will play the loser of that match over there. So I'll explain later. We have 4 players left. Double elimination. First from Royal Palm Beach, Florida. He's sponsored by Mez Q's, Precision Tips, Kamui, one of our top players in the U.S. for quite some time. And he's a top trainer and coach of the game, Hunter Lombardo, right there. And his opponent is from Toronto. He had a second place finish here not too long ago. I think it's only a matter of time before he adds this tournament to his repertoire of wins. He's a former Canadian 10-ball champion as well. He's won on our tour in the past as well. He's sponsored by QSportNation.com, Eric Horlison.
Okay.
All right, down here. First, both of these gentlemen are on our poster. There's very few left, so if you want them, you better hurry. From South Falls, South Dakota, 5-time U.S. Open 9-ball champ. Won this event 3 times, 2-time World Masters champ, 2-time all-around world champ, 11-time Moscone Cup Team USA member, Shane Van Boning. Just a kid. His opponent from Ackworth, Georgia, 6-time winner here. Between these two guys, they won 9 of these. The 6-time winner here, he's a former player of the decade in the 90s. He's a U.S. Open 9-ball champ. He's a 4-time world 9-ball champ, 18-time Moscone Cup Team USA member. That's 29 between the two of these guys. He's sponsored by Navigator Tips, Light Systems, Inc., our own display vendor up there, and Scorpion Q's, the incomparable Johnny Archer. All right. Please remember, everyone, turn the ringers off on your cell phones. They can be very distracting to the players. Players, please put yours away completely. And also, we have the live stream going on for free, azbilliards.com. Looks like Upstate Al, Mike Yednak, Donnie Mills. Hi, Donnie.
Hey.
And guest. We have a whole bunch of people in the back. So check that out, azbilliards.com. You get the free live stream. Let's not forget the Q raffle. We have a $1,200 Q. To give away today. So.
All right, we're going to mute Mike Zuglin, and Donnie Mills and Michael Yetnik are going to take it over. Thanks, guys.
Hey, guys. Thanks for having us. Looks like Shane won the lag, and he's about to break against Johnny Archer. It should be an exciting match.
Yeah, we're going to have the
best player in the world right now against the best player in the 90s. Kind of interesting matchup.
And the best player in the 90s got most of his titles playing nine ball. This is going to be tough.
That's true. Wow, that's unlucky.
Yeah, so he did the standard cut break, played the wing ball, and got a little nasty kick there. Took him right to the corner. Looks like Johnny has a 1-9 combination to start out the match, or he could go for the run out. The combination must be sitting really well because the run out's also pretty easy. So
yeah, I guess the rule of thumb is always which one's easier.
Yeah, which one are you going to get out more on? So he's just did percentages and says the 9 ball's easy. And it is. So one for Johnny. And that was a good break by Shane. Bad roll, I would say. Wouldn't you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Super unlucky there.
And when you're doing the cut break hard, that's really the typical pocket that you tend to get a bad kick in. But hard to fight that one.
Tell you who has this breakdown is the guy right behind him. You see Eric's break there? That guy's been breaking awesome this whole tournament.
He's been making the one ball and the wing ball, so he's playing the one as well. So you don't have to have as many balls locked if you're playing the one ball on the side.
Everyone out there, if you want to know how to break nine ball from the box, just watch these guys. Shane Van Boning and Eric Horlifson, they got it down. Let's see if Johnny has it too.
Or get a lesson from Donnie Mills.
Or do that. Johnny right, did so pretty good too. He almost scratched. A ball stopped him, but.
Yeah, he was actually playing the break I like a little more, which is hard and coming across the one ball. And you get the one ball in one quadrant and the cue ball in the other quadrant. So you have position on the one in the upper right corner.
I felt like Shane tried to do that, right, or no?
Yeah, I think so. I think he just got, like we saw, a nasty kick here. This is a little precarious. He's going to have to take some time to see what his best percentages are.
From this angle, I think he can come between the 3-2, maybe. But then the 1's going to be right there.
Yeah, if he plays the safety that...
Oh, he's going to push. All right, that's good.
He's trying to give himself a little better angle so he can achieve a safety off this.
Right.
I feel like he has to go for the combination here and not for the safety. And I think that's what Shane is seeing here. Unless he's playing the left side of the six and bringing the cue ball down and trying to get the cue or the one ball by the first diamond and the cue ball up table. Can't really see what he's doing from this angle. There is some, I just stood up. There's some pretty big space between the one and the six there. So this combo is possible. And
but not today. I'm surprised
that he went for it if it was that difficult.
Yeah. Well, here's the key shot of this rack. Just make the one and back and forth three times, I think. 1, 2, 3, and back to where he is now, I believe. That's the shot. Let's see how he does it. Straight high
English.
You can go
two rails or three rails. Donnie's saying three and Johnny's saying three.
Two. Okay. Hung that. That's...
uncharacteristic.
Yeah.
But the tables are starting to play a little tighter now, probably.
Yes, and this table, when I played on it, was super bouncy, especially the rail that he's shooting. He's bridging from now. I had some difficulty.
Extra spring?
Yeah, let's see. I mean, you can't really tell from there, but. And it was short. The angles are short.
Right.
Coming off short.
Jason played a bank in the last match, and it came short, and I was a little surprised because usually on new cloth it tends to bank a little more true, a little wider. You know,
yeah, this table's not playing
it goes short.
Like new cloth. Some of the other tables were, but this was nothing like new cloth.
So for me, the key was really the 3 to the 4 because the position on the 5 ball is a little challenging unless you get pretty thick on the 4, like a half ball hit or thicker.
Roll this in or do you punch it over?
Punch it over myself.
Me too.
A little bit of outside English, a little helping English here.
Just like that.
Yeah, the helping English makes that not throw as much, so you don't have to worry about overcutting the ball, oddly enough.
Yeah. I have a habit of anytime I have an angle, I use a hair helping English.
Okay.
If I can.
So we're both doing the opposite of who's that player that uses a touch of inside?
CJ Wiley.
Yeah, CJ Wiley is a touch of inside guy, and I'm an outside guy.
Yeah, me too.
He's a touch of outside and everything.
Yeah. Yeah, I've never tried that.
So this is a natural three railer, or he could draw back. The three railer takes away the scratches, so I'm assuming he's going with inside here.
He must be coming on the other side of the seven.
Yeah. One, two, three.
Yeah, I like that.
Hard to go wrong there. You have the corner of the side.
Yeah.
He got actually a little awkward.
He has to go up, I think.
I think he has to go in the corner. It's still new,
really?
New cloth. I would go up.
He's going the corner.
Yeah.
Wow. I must see something different. It looked like...
It's just too natural to get on the nine. If he took it in the side, he had to travel a lot to get back to the nine. I think he just wanted to punch it over to the nine. Easier, little easier position play. Tougher shot for the easier position play.
Now that's, what is it, 1-1? Or
yeah, it should be 1-1 now. Johnny did the combination on the nine, the first rack, and then Shane just ran that out. Shane, just so you guys know, is sponsored by Q-Tech. Q's Ultimate Team Gear, USA Pool Leagues. I know a lot of people have been asking about that carbon fiber shaft he's playing with. That is a Q-Tech shaft, and that should be available to the public in December. Johnny Archer is sponsored by Scorpion Q's Navigator Tips and Light Systems. Light Systems has a booth up here, really nice guys. Another really friendly booth here is the Baltimore City Q's. Mm. They sponsor a couple of the New York guys and a really nice company as well. So he's going back to the cut break, probably the five ball on the side. Should have a position on the one and the two if he doesn't pocket the one. Two balls
he
coming up table.
He hits it a lot harder than Johnny. He doesn't cut it as much. And he made one. What did he make? Did he make the corner ball?
I think he did. I was paying attention to the top balls coming up.
Yeah.
The nine ball moved a little bit, so it wasn't a perfect rack. But
Hunter just made one on the side from.
Got a good result. I might spin this into the six with inside, or you can go across two times. What do you like?
I go across two times with high English like this, or no?
He spun into the six. Yeah. Let's see. Did he get in trouble or did he get by the six and seven?
I must see something different on this monitor. I need to practice my monitor reading.
I think he's going to go two rails with inside or one rail with outside. He's got choices here. Looks like he went with outside. That's a touch
of
outside English.
That's a bouncy table.
Yeah. Now this, he'll probably go two rails, long rail, back towards the four. He does want to stay underneath the four so he can get position on the six. The seven precludes the left side, left corner pocket. He does have a side pocket. If he gets, funny, he might be able to play position for the side pocket as well.
I think he's definitely playing the four and the side. And even if he gets the wrong side, he could.
Yeah, I'm talking about the six ball. I think, the six ball is a little bit. I think the six ball really determines whether he wins the rack or not. So, and he actually might play for the six and the side with where he got. He has choice here. I think he can play for the corner of the side. But I slow roll this, go to the short rail and come up a little bit for the six ball on the side.
Oh, he went to the.
And he squirted across. So.
Interesting.
Would you have played that way, or would you have gone
I
to the short?
I think I might have went to the side, but I mean, you can't second guess him.
All right. So, top inside here.
Yep.
Probably two rails. I would try to go the long rail and touch it. He would ideally not be straight on this ball. Any angle is good angle on this ball, and he got dead straight. So he's not going to be frozen the rail. He'll probably try to use the side pocket to give him a full cue ball. Which he did. I think he came up a hair short, but he was trying to get right over the side pocket so he could see the whole cue ball.
Yeah.
Just a rule of thumb, if you do have your cue ball sort of near the rail and your position forces you to stay by the rail, you try to get in front of the side pocket so you have a full cue ball. It looks like Shane got straight in on that ball, though, so he may have just played to get straight.
Is it 2-1 now?
It is now 2-1 in favor of Shane. So far, no errors from either player. Shane got a bad kick, and it's been run out pulled. Johnny missed one shot, right in upper left corner.
Yes. Just let everyone out there know, every year I've come here, it's the same music over and over. So I like Shane's break like this. I like that he's cut breaking, giving himself a chance to make the corner ball or the one on the side. And if he doesn't, he's hitting him with such a hard pace where he might slop a ball in somewhere else. Look at that. Yeah, even if he doesn't make it, it's just
he made the
I'm
four on the one,
this.
And he's going to have a combo on the 2-9.
Yep, which is – or a carom. I can't tell which is better. Again, I don't read the screen very well for some reason.
Yeah, I like the combo, but he's definitely caroming. He's going to use a little bit of left English to make it a little bigger, I think. Another quick rack. That's one thing when you do hit him hard, you get a lot more quick racks. You know, if you play like a little softer cut break, you're running out the whole rack. You know.
Yeah.
That is one thing I've noticed. Unless you're pattern racking a specific way where the two is by the top and you're breaking on the other side.
That comes down to speed.
Right. But generally,
yes, you pattern rack for your so they end up in a certain place on how hard you hit them.
Right,
where,
right.
But
so most guys, when they rack, they'll put the two ball behind the nine because that has the less speed as far as the balls. The two, the five, and the eight ball will have the less speed. The eight ball will have the least speed, actually. Or, I'm sorry, the four ball will have the least speed from here. But the two and the five will also have less speed than the rest of the balls. So that's why you tend to put that ball near the back so it doesn't go all the way back up table where the cue is. So
yeah, I always put the 2-4 in the back and the 3-5 up front.
Right. And the 3-5 you put on one side, you'll usually have the 3-5 on one side of the table and the other two balls that are on the other side of the one ball on the other side of the table.
Especially if you know where your opponent normally breaks from.
Right.
This is what he practices all the time.
Yeah, torque this
like
back
this.
For the 3-ball. He's going to pull it straight back.
God.
And get a bad
what
roll.
What a punishment for such a good shot. Wow.
I guess he had to cheat the pocket, which is hard to do on these tight pocket tables. He would have had to cheat it slightly to the right as he was looking at it, so the cue ball would go to the left a little bit and miss the eight. That's asking a lot for that shot that he just had. He hit that really well.
That shot that not many people can really do that. A lot of people don't notice that, but... He practices it all the time. If you watch him practice, he's always practicing those stroke shots, and he's like,
there's something
people.
To that. Yeah, there's something
there
to
something.
That. Because I see, like, and this may be a false understanding, but I see Shane practicing tough shots. I see Strickland typically practicing tough shots.
Exactly.
I see some of the guys that I've always sort of respected a little more for their pocketing, really trying tough shots while they're practicing, whereas I'm more trying to get in rhythm, make sure I'm staying down the ball, just seeing the natural angles that I'm usually having where they're going for these jacked up full table length draw shots,
you know? Yeah.
there's something to that. I may need to start revising my workout before I start a match here.
Do we know what the score is with I can look on my app here.
Yeah, Hunter and Eric, I'm not sure what the score is with those two guys. You can go to azbilliards.com. They do have that up for us.
Yeah, that's where I'm going. We got Hunter Lombardo 2-0 and Van Boning 3-1.
All right. Guys, Eric on the other table, he said he doesn't have any sponsors except for one sponsor, and he's a really good player, guys. If anyone's looking to sponsor a player, Eric. Super nice guy and a really good player. He's currently sponsored by QSportNation.com, but he could use a couple other sponsors to help him get to more events and perform better than he already is. Now, Hunter is sponsored by, I think, Amsterdam Billiards. He plays there a lot. Kamui Products.
MezQs, I think.
MezQs as well. And I think he has another new Precision Tips or something like that.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, but just to do a shout-out to their sponsors as well. You can see them in the background. He's just going to follow. Oh, no, he's not.
Let's see. He came up on the 50-yard line, I think.
Yeah, he's gonna have
to. He's got to shoot in the corner for sure.
He's going to have to come with a good shot in the corner here and missed a side pocket scratch, which we all know how to do. But but he has hit this with a little bit of inside English and accept a little longer shot in the nine as well.
I don't know about you guys, but I hate this shot.
This is one of the shots I practice regularly.
I do too. A shot like this with English, I just shoot it over and over, and I try to remember the spot that I aim at. And then down on, when I get under pressure, I just get down and let my instincts, I go to the spot, even though sometimes I want to change it, and I just stick to that, you know, when you're practicing and you remember.
Yeah.
That's what I do on the shot. And
Johnny hit it chubby.
And he might have got, no.
I mean, even if he got away with it, this is an easy kick and natural position to the nine.
Yeah.
But as it stands, it may be tougher to get shape on the nine. It might be, you know.
Right. He's got to really kill this ball. Down or he's got to kill it.
He's got to kill this ball with inside English and hit it thin enough to make it.
He's going to hit the tip. No.
The tip. Yeah, he just missed the tip.
Yeah. And he's, what, straight in the corner probably?
Yeah, he'll spear this in the corner.
Camera three. Let's see if we can get a view. I can't see. I've never seen him miss this ball. Oh, this is straight in.
This
I mean, almost
a sliver. He's got to cut this a sliver to the left side of the ball. Now, how I aim this is I look at the top of the ball as opposed to the center of the ball, and I take ticks to the left. So I would hit this at, like, 11:58. Because I just want to cut it, you know, like two ticks over, like 2 degrees. So anyway, nice. Actually, that was a very tough shot to play position on the eight ball. Whenever balls are in the pockets, those are sort of challenging position shots because you can make the ball so many different ways. You got to be very deliberate about how you make the ball so that you can get shape. So Shane's checking the rack, deciding what side to break from. He's been breaking from the right side, continues to break from there. So we should see the seven rocket into the corner and the one ball near the side. And should end up in the quadrant where he is if he doesn't make it in the side. And it's in the quadrant where he was. And he almost made it. And he lost his cue ball a little bit.
Though.
He lost his cue ball a bit. Now, obviously, jump cues were allowed. This would be a jump shot, I think.
Yeah, for sure. Let me ask you something. When you watch Shane, when he breaks nine ball, is he? I haven't been paying attention. Does he use just his arm, or is he using a little transition with his body too? Have you?
I wasn't paying attention to that.
Let's look at that.
We'll sweat that next time he breaks here. He's definitely jumping this, which. I gotta admit, with that low deflection shaft, I'm surprised. I'm surprised he jumped with that.
I guess he felt like he had no other choice.
Does he not have a break? Is he breaking with his shooting cue? I didn't notice.
I don't know.
Yeah, Shane just has one cue out, so he's using his shooting cue as his break cue, and in this tournament, it's a little bit of a different rule than other places, which I actually like. You're not allowed to use jump cues. You
I
can
love
use your
that.
Break cue. You can use your shooting cue. But you can't go and whip out a baby stick or
I hate
a short
jump
stick.
Cues. I think it's an insult to the game. I have one, of course.
Yeah, we have to have one.
You have to have one.
You have to be able to
I
play
think it's
it.
A joke is what I think.
Yeah, but in that case, I think he would have done well with a high deflection shaft because then you can
yes.
jump the ball easier. Where his his new shaft that he's playing with is a very low deflection shaft, and it's a carbon fiber, so it's very light in the front. And it's just not going to push the ball off the slate as easily.
This tournament, your break cue should be a high deflection shaft just in case you have to break. See, this table really boings. Look at this.
He didn't hit that hard, but he definitely
So
he could have been anywhere on the other side of this five, and this rack's a foregone conclusion, where now he's got work at himself. And I guess he's playing for shape on the six in the corner where he's standing, right?
I don't
think he can play for the side. Unless he goes four rails. One, two,
wow, I can't
three,
believe this.
Four. So he went the four rail route for position on the six and the side.
This
and,
is not Johnny Archer.
Yeah, I think even the great Johnny Archer feels the heat of a monster, Shane Van Boning, you know.
Well, this table, I mean, I played on this table, and it got me out of, I won the match, but it got me out of rhythm. I just started guessing on how hard I'm supposed to hit certain shots.
Do you think that's the lights, or do you think that this...
I don't think it's the lights. Normally, light heats the table. Normally, it...
plays a little more consistent, right?
Yeah. I'm not sure what it is, but it's not that.
Maybe there's an air conditioning unit right now. All these are new diamond tables, guys. The tables play great. It's just this particular scenario, this table's playing a little bit quicker than is ideal for position play.
Yeah.
He just got perfect on this ball. He traveled all the way around the table and got on the correct side of the six. And he'll just float this up a little bit, get off the rail so he doesn't have a rail shot in the eight ball. And follow off the rail here. Follow on the eight ball, and nine ball will be an easy shot.
I wonder why it switched cameras on us. Oh, we want camera one.
we got our camera technician fixing the.
We got our camera technician on a warning. Second time <it's> fired.
So Shane just won another rack. Looks like the score is now 4-1. 5-1, 5-1. Sorry, our technician's a little slow over there with the scoring.
Now, just so you guys know, Johnny Archer is one of the few players left out there that still plays with high deflection.
Oh, that is interesting.
Yeah.
You know, I know Alex Paguline also plays with the high deflection shaft.
False.
No, true.
Bet.
Sure.
Really? You're that confident?
I'm absolutely confident. I will bet you right now.
He must have just started playing with it.
Yeah. Alex is definitely currently playing with a high deflection shaft. He's playing with Carmelli Qs and Carmelli shafts, and they are high deflection.
When did he start doing this?
He's not playing with a Mez or an OB or a Predator or anything like that.
He used to play with a Predator.
I know.
When did he switch to high deflection?
Do we got a bet or no? Because
we'll
Facebook Alex.
I never would dream that he would switch.
Yeah, he switched
after all
over. Alex and. Alex plays with the high deflection, and so does Thorsten Holman also.
Thorsten Holman does, Rodney Morris does, Efren Reyes does, Bustamante does.
Earl Strickland?
Earl Strickland does. After that, I'm not sure who else.
Most of the younger generation plays with the low deflection shaft. I think all of us grew up with Predator.
I wish I started with high deflection.
Yeah, you switched over?
I switched 4 years ago. It took me 3 years to figure it out, really, consistently. I wish I would have started from the beginning with low deflection. It's easier to play the game.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah, it's like...
Alex is has played with low deflection for several years.
Do you know why he switched?
I do. He All plays right. a lot of one pocket, and okay. his primary reason is he likes to be able to change the angles. And with the low deflection shaft, you're limited to certain angles. You can't really manipulate the angle that you're approaching the object ball as much.
Okay.
And he is a firm believer that he likes to feel the shot and manipulate the angle more. And with a low deflection shaft, if you're aiming at a point on the ball, that's the point you're going to hit on the ball. Where, yeah.
Wow.
Yep.
That's from the best one pocket player in the world.
Yeah, best what one pocket, yeah, and he says it's easier to bank.
What a pool genius. He can switch from low deflection to high. Wow.
Yeah, he went back to high deflection.
Amazing. All right, so that's going to make it, 5-2?
I believe it's 5-2. Our technician's on that.
Oh, just an update on the other
table. 5-2.
Eric Horlofsson is trailing Hunter Lombardo 4-0.
Now, I don't know about you, but I've seen Hunter for several years, and this is he's really starting to play a lot more consistent these last 9 months. I would say he's really upped his game.
Yes, for sure.
He's always had a really nice stroke and really good mechanics, and I thought that his pocketing has jumped up. But I don't know what you feel about that, but...
I think everything's jumped up.
Yeah.
Now let's see if...
So he's playing the four ball and possibly the one ball as well.
In the side, yeah. And there it is. He made them both.
Right.
but not a, you know, this is no
fun. Well, the two ball was on the bottom, and I think he played the cue ball to the bottom because of where the position of the two ball was, and he thought that he might make the one and was playing lower table. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Because I will do that. If the two ball's racked where the six was racked, I will do exactly what he did, and I'll play for the cue ball to come down table, and I'll play the one in the side. But
it's kind of unlucky, you know?
Yeah. I have to believe he was playing the one ball on the side because he made both the one ball and the wing ball. And because the two ball was at the bottom of the rack.
Right. And he shot out at his hole. Then left Shane a shot that Shane never misses. And
hopefully none of us ever miss, but when we do, we're on full tilt.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's going to hit this with follow, go to the short rail, come back up to the middle of the table. He'll have easy shape on the three. I'm pretty sure it goes by the six. So as long as the three goes by the six, he'll just play straight up and back down table.
He is hooked almost.
Went towards the seven. Maybe to make sure he had a good angle on the three. I think I would have come more straight up the table and had more of a cut angle on this three ball, but I'm not going to question Shane and his decision making. So, you know, I would have tried to get on the other side of the five. Now he's got to go to the table or go to the rail and back out. Or he might be thick enough where he can draw out. Depends on how thick this angle is. Maybe he's thicker than I think. Maybe he can draw this straight back.
I don't know, it's hard to say.
Yeah, he had to punch it out. It's a good shot. And Shane's stroke is so powerful that he, you know, can go to the rail and out easier than other guys. That looked like a very shallow angle to me. So I think most guys would have had to hit that really hard, but he's just a taller guy, so he's got a little bit of a longer stroke.
Is he jacked up here?
This is an error.
This looks funny.
Yeah, that was an error. There was no reason to be jacked up over the nine. Makes the shot much more difficult. Of course, Shane's favored to make this ball, but if he had to shoot this 10 out of 10 times, he would rather not be over the nine.
Of course. Oh, he's fine, though.
Yeah. He made it straight in the pocket. Natural position to the nine from the eight.
All ball fouls if you follow through. This tournament's all ball fouls if you stop before you shoot the ball.
Yeah.
Then it's not a foul. And I haven't seen it called once the whole tournament. Actually, I've never seen it called here, so.
I'm getting a little personal. About 6 to 9 months ago, I saw Shane, and he was a little thicker, and I saw Shane working out here, and it looks like he's trimmed back up.
He said he's worked out every day here.
Got back in shape here. I'm sure that's part of why he's playing well. I do believe that working out helps you play better, whether it be running aerobic or lifting. Helps with your confidence and helps with your ability to cope with scenarios.
Yeah.
You know, mental.
But, you know, he's been, for the last, I don't know, year or two, he seems to win everything. Just everything. He's
last year? I feel like it's been the last 7-10 years.
Yeah.
Maybe I'm exaggerating. It just seems like he's been winning everything since I've been following him, since he got on the scene. Wow. Definitely not soft breaking.
No. He's giving himself a chance to.
I think he's supposed to put the one behind the eight and put the cue behind the seven here.
It's now. What's the score?
Shane might cut this in the corner. Shane does practice this shot a lot, cutting it in the corner. For me, cutting this ball in the corner, I have a tendency to get collision-induced throw, and I'm not sure how much I'm going to get. And sometimes I'll hit this ball dead on, and the collision-induced throw will throw the one ball right into the long rail, and I'll miss the ball. You can use a little bit of outside English to correct that, or you can play the safe. And I've lost so many times going for the shot that I tend to play safe. Let's see what a world-class, multi-world champion does. Pockets it.
Wow.
And hits it to the outside of the pocket.
Wow.
I don't know what he does with the three. I kind of like the safety just because the position of the three. The three, the five, the nine is all congested. There's not an easy safety that I see. He can leave him jacked up over the nine, you know. Possibly get the three carom on the five.
Oh, he's playing for the carom, yeah.
Yeah, he's playing for the carom on the five. I feel like you got to get pretty perfect on this to play the carom.
Yeah.
You know, like, this is not an easy or natural carom. He's got to get the right angle on this. He was pointing to where he wanted to be. Speaking of Alex, Alex is crazy good at carom shots.
Oh, I don't think he might be hooked. I can't.
He is. His
I might be able to see a piece of it. I don't know.
It's Johnny stood up to see it. And
Johnny's going to call a ref to watch the hit, maybe. I would think. I would.
Yeah, here's where.
That's a little bit of gamesmanship, too. You ask the ref to watch. I mean, I know when a ref comes over to watch a hit for me, it adds a little heat to me.
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like we should by now be able to handle that little heat.
No, yeah, but you it's know. Just an added little.
This is definitely a situation where I would get a ref because like he could easily hit the nine first. You
it's
know,
like
it's
a bathroom
legitimate.
Break. You're up 7-4, and no, you're down 7-4, and you come back, and it's 7-6, and then he misses a ball. You take your bathroom break then. You let him sit there and dwell on that for 5 minutes. And it's
what do you think?
I call it gamesmanship.
Man, I got you. I don't like those moves. You know,
it's
I
not
think
a move. It's you got to your bathroom break is part of.
Yeah, so he lets him jack the board in the nine. That
oh,
was
I
my
like this.
My initial thought. He actually ended up playing a super solid safety and was able to get him behind the eight. And even if he didn't hide him behind the eight, he had him jack the board with the nine. You know,
yes.
that was a well played, well thought out shot. I probably would have played safety on the one, and then I would have to deal with that three-ball situation later. He decided to play to the three, play position for the safety.
Yeah, I don't like this at all. This is terrible. Oh, he hit it, though, and he – did he make it? I can't.
He made it.
Wow.
and he's
hooked.
I just want to thank Jonathan Lewin for your gracious donation. Thank you, Jonathan. And also Joshua Cohen, thank you for your donation. Appreciate it.
He's got a reasonable kick safety here. I'm not saying that he's supposed to leave him safe, but he could go two rails, long rail, short rail, clip the five
goes into
thinly,
the nine. Yeah.
Goes towards the seven, hopefully gets behind the seven, leaves good separation. The five might go behind the nine or hit the nine and have some speed slow down. You know, if he can get good separation here and get the cue around the seven, he might be all right. He could also whale at it and try to get lucky.
Hit that thicker than I thought, but he's going to.
That was a great shot,
yeah.
too. You know,
oh, yeah.
He hit the same thought that I was thinking,
yeah,
but he hit the five ball much thicker.
Yeah,
you know,
hit it almost perfect.
So, I mean, here I think, and you could correct me, Johnny, but I think he could play a stop shot, leave him over the nine again, and play a shot on the five in the corner, bank it.
That's true.
With inside English, I think you can do a stop shot here with inside, leave him jacked up over the nine, and it'll be slightly to the right where if you do happen to make the five, you should have a good shot on the seven. He's playing a much smarter shot, going two rails, trying to get behind the seven. Missed it that, but did.
Now Johnny's going to try the same thing.
Did hold the five well, you know, with the nine ball. He played a good shot holding the five. I was thinking a little aggressive safety, and he thought all-out safety. Shane obviously weighed out the percentages, decided on the strongest safety percentage that he had. And Johnny's going to try to get him behind the seven here as well. And he's going to bank it towards the eight. He's going to bank the five towards the eight, try to get the cue ball behind the seven. I focus all attention on the cue ball behind the seven.
Yes.
Here.
And he's that works too.
Yeah,
gave
I don't
himself
like
a chance to win, I guess.
I don't like that as much, but, you know, again, this is a situation where Johnny's experience is much higher than mine, so I think he had to have taken the right shot there. I would play the shot I said before, though. Try to put him behind the seven here. Let's see what Shane feels is right. And when I'm saying behind the seven, short, long, short. I don't go short, long, short. Yeah, he's doing it the way I like.
Wow,
and he's going to end up
perfect.
With a good result. And that's the shot I thought Johnny would have played before. And the reason I like that so much is because it is very reasonable to execute. And once you hit that third rail, the long rail, it's going towards the short rail. If it hits the short rail, almost all the speeds off the ball. So it's actually a bigger ball safety than you'd suspect, and that's a shot that I practice regularly. That particular safety is a big safety in nine ball, and you have to have that in your arsenal. The other shot Johnny played also is a shot you should have where you play the to make it, but you play with the speed that it comes back to the middle of the table with the rail first, you know.
Wow.
That's two kicks that Johnny made. Both scenarios, I feel like Shane hit good shots on him and didn't get rewarded, you know. Shane hit two great safeties and both situations. Now, it's only going to cost him one game because it was both this rack.
True.
That is positive out of it. I come one rail here. You could go two rails, but I would come one rail.
I really don't believe this.
He went one rail. Would you have gone two rails on that? Would you have spun that with a little bit outside and tried to go two rails, or would you have gone one
rail? That shot, again, it's one of those shots where I practice and I just kind of memorize where to. I know it sounds ridiculous.
No, it doesn't.
And I don't really miss that ball much, and I'm good at slow rolling it.
But you would go one rail. You wouldn't have gone short rail to the long rail towards the eight, right? You would have gone one rail.
Yeah, I just would have hit it one rail.
Now, this shot I hit with top inside. You could go outside as well. And Shane favors that outside two rails. But
or he's just going to
that is not what I would have done.
Off angle a little, but to him it's like nothing.
Yeah. The good thing about this is you can use the outside English on this shot, and it actually makes the ball in the pocket huge, you know, like.
What he reminds me of, have you ever played that video game Virtual Pool before?
I have, yes.
Well, the toughest guy there, right? He makes everything, like your opponent. I played the very toughest guy, and he'll leave himself shots like that and just makes them, two strokes them all in. And that's pretty much what Shane does, the same thing.
Shane's your Virtual Pool nemesis?
Yeah, exactly. Hi, how you doing? I think she wants your attention. All right, so the score.
This is this bossy woman back here that asking for stuff from me.
The score is now, is it 7-2? I don't know.
We should check the scorekeeper. She says it's 7-2.
And Hunter Lombardo is 5-2 up, unless they haven't switched the score because he's racking right now. Look, you see the speed? He hits with his speed, and he's made a ball every time, even if he misses the corner ball. That's what I love about his break. I'm going to start practicing it. I think it might be more effective. But I don't – did you see if he is using all arms?
I did not.
Me neither. Next time we'll do it.
I got distracted again.
Keep forgetting.
Do you think he cuts this and goes short rail, and comes all the way back down for the two?
The two's all the way down here. He just goes forward, right?
I don't think he can hold it, can he? You said this really bouncy.
Wow.
Oh, he had the corner.
God, he if you notice, he just makes these hard shots over and over. That's the difference between him and he breaks better.
Well, his break is obscene. Like,
he breaks better, and he makes all those hard shots better than all of us. That's the difference, really.
In 10-ball.
10-ball, too, he breaks too good.
I don't think there's anybody that breaks better than Shane.
No.
In 9-ball, there's a lot of good breakers in 9-ball. I like your break, Donnie. I like his break. I like a lot of different guys. I like that it's not rack your own 9-ball break.
Yeah.
I would prefer with my preferences, which are kind of, you know, I would like a magic rack or a rack and just alternate break, and whoever breaks and runs the most wins.
Yeah, yeah. That's not bad. That's
I know you're kind of a knowledgeable player when it comes to the break as well, so I like that little advantage. So he's just going to draw straight back. He doesn't want to be on the rail for the 7, obviously, and I think he's got enough angle where he can pop off the rail and get close to the 7.
And he's gone too far. No,
I know.
Perfect.
He went a little too far.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he was able to check it with inside, so he's good. So he used inside,
boing?
So right English. Yeah, a little further than you'd expect, yeah.
Table's boingy, but for him. And just like that, we've got a 8-2, is that right?
Affirmative.
Wow.
So.
Kopeny, wait, what was that? What, 9-ball or 10-ball? Maybe both.
Someone's saying Kopeny is the best 10-ball breaker.
Break gets the last two at least. You're saying Kopeny needs the last two from Shane or gives the last two to Shane?
I'm not sure.
We'll have to see. Okay, Johnny's going to rack the balls again. You know Eric Horlifson back there? I played him in a third or fourth round winner's match, and third, I think. And he broke and ran probably six racks against me.
He was playing the one on the side, right?
I can't believe it.
Yeah, he was playing the one ball on the side, too.
He was making the corner ball, too. 10-ball.
Guys, just to reiterate some of the sponsors here, we have Kamui on the screen. They're actually my sponsor as well, and I believe who are your sponsors, Donnie?
I don't really have sponsors.
Sponsor yourself?
Yeah.
Donnie's self-sponsored pool player.
Yeah, I pay all my own expenses.
So Johnny Archer is sponsored by Scorpion Q's, Navigator Tips, and Light Systems. Light Systems has a booth up here. Baltimore City Q's also has a booth up here. Very nice people over there as well. Shane is sponsored by Q-Tech. The new carbon fiber shaft that he's playing with will be available in December. I know a lot of players are excited about that possibility, especially a lot of the upcoming players. On top of that, he's sponsored by Ultimate Team Gear and USA Pool Leagues. My sponsors, I'm going to do a quick shout-out to Jacoby Custom Q's, Amsterdam Billiards, Kamui Products again, Revo, Predator Shaft, technology as well. And looks like Johnny's going to have a good opportunity
have a
here. Yeah, he's
a little window opportunity.
Now, here's where a high deflection shaft is ideal.
Yes, I was just thinking that. This was one of the shots I loved with high deflections. I miss it, actually, but it's... Well, I guess Johnny doesn't like it as much as I did, but...
So that particular
shot...
then
again, he's down 8-2, so I know that shot is way harder when you're down 8-2, and somehow when you're up 8-2, it goes right in. What were you saying? That shot what?
That shot's definitely easier with the high deflection shaft as opposed to low deflection, and I think those are the type of shots, you know, like an example of a shot that Alex was really like, look, try to play this shot, and trying to do with my low deflection, and it just, you know, you have to really judge it differently than a high deflection shaft. And I try the high deflection, it goes in, you know, 9 out of 10. It's kind of funny, you know, and then I show him a shot, you know, it's just different scenarios.
You know, speaking of breaking with your playing cue, when I look back, when I did my best in tournaments, I was actually playing and breaking with my playing cue at the time. It's kind of funny, and Shane's doing that too. Maybe there's something to it.
Who knows? You're used to the same balance. It's whenever I was making a break cue for myself or I was trying to get a break cue, I always wanted to feel as close to my shooting cue as possible. So I had that same feel, that same comfort that I have that I'm playing with, you know, 8 other shots. Now you got the break shot, and then you're hopefully pocketing a ball. You got 8 shots left. But this could be the match, guys. Shane's put on a little clinic here. You know, playing very strong pool.
Yes.
This shot, I might actually go for the other pocket. Now he's back cutting it. I like that as well. He's basing that on positioning, so he's going to go long rail for position. He needs that bounce that Donnie's been talking about to get him in good shape. And
he's good. This is over.
It's a little awkward, but I think he's good. You know, it could bounce a little far, but he's still going to have a good shot.
It is a little awkward, but for him, it's just a joke.
Another hanger?
Yeah. I mean, it really is.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, my God. I'm sorry, Shane. I'm sorry, Shane. Jesus.
Donnie, you got him.
Yeah, I got him. Donnie. I apologize. I should never say
I said it was awkward, and Donnie argued with me.
Mark Kendall, you said, what pool hall has smoking? Well, where I live, the question is, what pool hall doesn't smoking?
All right, so Johnny stays alive here. A little resurrection for Johnny Archer. He's got a...
And the answer is, I don't know of a pool room that's non-smoking, unfortunately. What?
So Johnny's got an opportunity here that he probably didn't expect to have, and he's got to capitalize on that. The current score is now 3-8. I'm sure there's many a time that Johnny's played where he's come back from that scenario. I'm sure he'd like to not be there, but he is. So yep. He's just got to make that comeback right now.
Here we have someone come in the booth. Now he's gone. I don't.
So Joey.
What's he looking for?
Al's son's popping in looking for some equipment.
Oh, okay. And it looks like Johnny's going to be sleeping in the streets with this break.
Yeah, he came up trying. Looks like a 3-9 combination ends the set. So he's going to pull back a little bit on the one, leave a nice angle where he can Z back towards the 3-9. He'll probably leave a little bit of a thin cut.
Exactly, Muhammad Ali.
He'll leave a thin cut so that when he does play the 3 into the 9, the cue ball will go up towards the 7. So even if he were to miss the 9, he'll still be safe.
He just got really
thick. So he must be playing not the combo.
Yeah, I think he wanted to be a little.
Yeah, that might have been an error. Might not have been.
I don't know if he could draw this back. And
I think it's thick enough he can miss the 5 and come back to the short rail and out. I would draw this past position rather than just try to get it past the 5. Of course, if you hit it softer, you can hold the angle. So he might hit it softer to hold the angle, and he did. So the power stroke would have been good if he didn't have to miss the 5. But since he had to miss the 5, he chose to sort of do a cinch draw where he just got past the 5 and accepted a longer cut on the 3. I believe the 7 could come into play here. So he might put a little bit of inside and go short rail, back for the 4 in the opposite pocket that he plays the 3. I would do that myself. I'm not sure if he...
Here's a shot where me personally, I don't use any English. I do whatever it takes. I just make it and go back and forth. I don't know. This is a hard for me. This is a hard shot. I try to do whatever I think I can to 100% make this. And Shane, let's see what he does.
Yeah, I'm afraid of hitting the 7, so I use touch of inside. Let's see if he uses a touch of inside here.
I feel like if you aim high and thin, would you miss the 7? I don't know.
You probably would, but if you do it a little chubby, you're hitting the 7.
But if you hit the right side of the 7, you're kind of not in any danger, right?
You're definitely hitting the right side of the 7. Yeah. I just feel like it might stop the cue ball progress and leave him on the short rail or leave him awkward on the 4. Whereas I feel if I use a little inside English, it helps me cut the ball a little more in this particular case because it deflects slightly.
So you feel more confident cutting this with
inside.
Wow.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah.
I do. But it doesn't look like Shane is using inside.
Let's see what he's doing.
He almost looks like he's drawing the ball, which could mean he could actually play safe. Like, look, if I don't like it, I gotta jam up safety
here.
He's got the 5-6 to high behind if he doesn't like it.
Yeah, I really like cutting this in with just high English. No inside whatsoever.
See, I would either use center or inside, but I wouldn't use draw.
He played safe. No, he didn't.
Yeah, he did.
He did, of course. Well, why wouldn't he be hooked? You're up 8-3.
Nah.
This happens. Johnny missed all those balls early on, and this is what starts happening.
Do you think he was trying to draw into the 5 and 6? I think he was, right? He was trying to play that and draw into the 5 and 6, missed the 5 and 6.
Oh, really?
He missed
I thought
3.
He was trying to cut the 3 in.
No. I think he was trying to cut the 3 and go into the 5-6.
Maybe.
And since he missed it, he ended up missing the 5-6 and ended up safe. I think he got lucky there. I don't think he played that.
Johnny just kicked his wallet.
Yeah, he didn't take a lot of time to look at that. That might have been a little bit of a...
Again, the table's playing kind of short. Bouncy, the angles are playing shorter. He's probably... I don't know. That's what I noticed when I played on it.
Yeah. 4 to the 5 is the only chance that Johnny's gotten. It's not that difficult.
Yeah, yeah, this is a little tricky, right? He's got to. Where's
he
the 5?
He ended up leaving left the 4 a little funky.
Yeah, where's he play the 5?
He's got to play the 5 for the lower left corner. Pop it out.
Wow, he's such a powerful stroke. It's funny.
Right.
Wow. Let's see another angle here. He just rolls this in.
Yeah, he's probably going to play this in the side. I like the left side. Yeah. Now he's got a...
This match is over.
I actually pull up a little bit and play the seven to the side and come back. Yeah. Okay, he had another angle.
Like having an angle, two rails towards the eight. High,
two
right
or three,
English,
or two
maybe
or three
center,
rails.
Low, like one. Yeah, I meant
two,
yeah,
two or three
rail.
Rails. Yeah, yeah. Yep. He just doesn't want to get dead straight, and he's
he did.
Almost dead straight.
Well, like we said,
I
earlier,
thought I was the only one that did that.
Tell you what, though, but dead straight is better than like six inches out.
It's better than missing the ball too.
Yeah.
Oh, he had a hair of angle because he was able to get off the rail. So
this match is over. 7-2, Hunter over Eric.
All right, guys. Score. So thanks for watching, guys. Again, thanks to Jacoby, Custom Cues, Kamui, Predator, and Amsterdam Billiards. Thanks, guys. And special thanks to Donnie for sitting in with us. And
thanks
to Al.
Thanks for having me.
My wife, Christine.
Absolutely. Your wife's been helping out behind the scenes. Whether you know it or not, guys, Christine's been changing the score, changing the camera work. Donnie, thank you so much.
You're
Mike,
welcome.
Yeah, Nick, two professionals in the booth. Thanks, guys. We'll be back in a little while, guys.
Thanks, Al. Have a good day, guys. You too.